Let's have some church this morning. See, I'm not ashamed to lift up the name of Jesus. If we keep silent, the rocks will cry out, blessed be the King. And if we don't praise Him, the earth will shout, blessed be the King. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Let all the world sing praises to the King. Sing hallelujah. Him, blessed be the King. We are His children, we worship Him. Blessed be the King. Sing hallelujah. You don't hear me. Sing hallelujah. Let all the world sing praises to the King. Sing hallelujah. I'm gonna sing hallelujah. Let all the world sing praises to the King. Sing hallelujah. I'm gonna sing hallelujah.
That. Thank you so much, Brother Bill, for blessing us first thing this morning. First of all, we just want to let you guys know we've got a ton of events coming up in February and March, so I hope you guys are ready. Get your calendars out, because we're going to start listing them all. For all of our ladies, we are going to have a Galentine's Ladies Tea this coming Saturday, February 17th. So all of our ladies in the church are invited. If you didn't get an invitation, let me know. I'll be happy to get you one. We are going to have some tasty treats, and we are going to have some hot tea, and we'll have some water and some other little goodies if you're not a tea drinker. As my sister says, she's not a big tea person. She feels like tea is muddy water, so I'm a little offended by that because I'm a big tea lover myself, but that's okay. So for those of you that are not tea drinkers, we'll have some other fun things. And this is just going to be a fun time. We're going to have a fun activity. Amen. And we're going to have a time of fellowship for us just to all get to know each other a little better. Then on Sunday, February 25th, if you guys will join me for a Vacation Bible School kickoff event. Woo, yes. It is going to be very quick because we do have our International Harvest Church that's going to be coming in to worship, so we don't have a whole lot of time, but we are going to just have a little open house, kind of a little preview, so you can see what the theme is all about, and if you want to really, really be cool, then you want to sign up to volunteer for Vacation Bible School.
Amen.
And you better get in quick, because those spots fill up fast. We have an amazing church that I could not be more proud of, and everybody in this church just jumps in and gets involved in Vacation Bible School. So, and if you can't be here during the actual week of Vacation Bible School, just come and see how you can pray for us, because we can definitely use all the prayer we can get. So just keep that in mind. And then we're going to have a little movie that's going to show everybody about just kind of a little teaser preview about Vacation Bible School. Hopefully we will have a little teaser preview of the movie. And this year's VBS theme is called Scuba.
Ooh.
It's actually just a one word, that's it, Scuba. And it's going to be a lot of fun. It's all going to be based, if you can't guess from the theme, underwater. So I think you guys are going to really enjoy that. So let's see, hopefully, let's cross our fingers. And technology is always a funny thing, but there we go.
Amen.
All right, so that looks like a lot of fun. I think you guys are going to love it. Oh. Yeah, that's, sorry, I thought it was over, but it wasn't quite over. Just like Vacation Bible School, you think it's over, but it's never really over. All right, and then in March, believe it or not, we've got an early Easter this year, and Easter is coming up in March. So Sunday, March 24th, is our very special Palm Sunday service. So we invite everybody to come, bring your friends, bring your family,
yes,
and join us for a very special Palm Sunday service. Then we are going to do something a little different this year. On Friday, March 29th, we are going to have a very special evening Good Friday service.
Amen.
Yes, so we are very excited about that. More details will be coming a little bit later. We're still firming all those up. And then on Sunday, March 31st, that is Easter Sunday. So make sure that you definitely come. You do not want to miss this. We are, Brother Bill and the praise team are going to bring us some gorgeous, gorgeous music. And Brother Oscar is going to bring us an amazing Easter sermon to really inspire us. He may not know it yet, but he is. And no, he knows. He's got it. So again, definitely bring all your friends and family. And then we want to say a big thank you to everyone who has just been giving so generously from their heart to help support all of our ministries. We have our Vacation Bible School Fund. We have our Together We Build Fund. That helps us, the Together We Build helps us with the upkeep and the maintenance of the church. We also have our Operation Christmas Child, which, again, I know it's Christmas. I know we've got a ways to go, but if we start giving now, then we'll have plenty of money when the time comes to actually do our Operation Christmas Child ministry. And then we also have our Share the Load Fund. And this fund allows us to bless our ministers in the church. We are not a traditional church. A lot of the bigger churches out there have staff that are full-time paid staff members. We do not have that. Every single staff member is volunteer, purely doing this out of the goodness of their own heart. And so they get no salary. And what we do instead is every year in October for Pastor Appreciation, we bless them with some gifts, just some minor tokens of appreciation to say thank you for all they do. So every penny that you put into that Share the Load Fund goes specifically to bless them. And we definitely believe that a workman is worthy of his pay. So we definitely want to bless them and say thank you to them for their hard work. And now we are going to turn this service back over to Brother Bill and the praise team. I hope you guys are ready because he's got some good stuff planned.
As Becky said, it is good to be in the house of the Lord. It really Amen. Is. And so we're going to continue with our service. This song says, "Create in me." You all know the story of David and his prayer that he gave to the Lord. And so today, let us go before him and let us continue with our praise.
Sacrifice pleasing to God is a broken spirit. You'll not despise a humble heart. You will hold and heal it. Renew.
After yours, Please stand for the reading of God's Word. This morning, our scripture reading comes from the book of Philippians, the first chapter, and verse 21. Would you read with me, please? For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. You may be seated. Almighty Lord, you are the creator of heaven and earth. You made it. You sustain it. You own it. It is yours to do with as you please. Lord, thank you for making it for us, for putting us here, for providing everything it takes for us to live, from air to breathe and water to drink to food to eat, to the materials it takes to make clothing and shelter and everything else. And Lord, you did not leave us alone, but you gave us family and friends and co-workers. You gave us purpose. And then when we messed things up by sinning, you sent your very own Son to dwell among us, to teach us, then to sacrifice himself on a Roman cross to forgive us of sin. But you didn't leave him dead. You brought him back to life on the third day, that we could know he was Lord of lords and King of kings. He ascended to heaven to be with you, but he left the promise that he's coming again to rule here on earth in righteousness and truth, to restore all things. We look forward to that day. Until then, help us to serve you, to proclaim your word, to proclaim the forgiveness of sin in Jesus' name until he returns. In your almighty name, amen.
The song, the hymn says, "For to me to live is Christ," as Brother Frank just said in the scripture reading. The song, this hymn, Jesus is all the world to me. Each and every day in my walk, it's all about letting others know the Christ that I have in me, the Christ that lives in me, that they can see it in me. Because Jesus is all the world to me. He should be all the world to you. Let us stand. Because we're having some church here today. Let us stand and sing this beautiful hymn, Jesus is all the world to me.
When he's so true to me.
may have a seat.
As we go into the stewardship portion of our service today, our thought comes out of 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 25. In here, Paul is talking about running a race, and we have to understand that being a Christian is like being in a race. And what the key thing in this verse is saying, that everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we forget about that, because discipline or discipleship requires discipline, and giving requires discipline. We have to train ourselves in order to continue. And as we express our love for others through our giving, we have to understand that as we give, we are growing more in Christ's likeness. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time we have to worship you with our tithes, our offerings, our gifts. And we know that at times it is a struggle. But like anything, it takes practice. And as we get to practice more and more, it becomes second nature.
Yes.
And we just thank you, Lord, for providing for us to help us understand that you will watch over us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
All that I have, I lay them down before you.
Today, as we continue in our odyssey here in the book of Ecclesiastes, we are in chapter 11. So if you have your Bibles, you can go ahead and turn to 11. We're going to be looking at verses 7 to 12. Well, verses from 11:7 through chapter 12, verse 8. So we're looking at pretty much here, so just stay with me. And the core theme of today's message is the idea of remembering, specifically remembering our Creator, and more specifically, remembering our Creator while we're young. Now, speaking of remembering, and before I go too much farther into the message, do you know of or remember the country music singer Glen Campbell? You know, it hadn't been that long ago. You know, he not only sang, but he wrote songs too. He played different instruments and did backup for many different musicians. He's most notably known for his songs, Wichita Lineman, Rhinestone Cowboy, you know, Southern Nights. He produced 70 albums, of which 12 turned gold, 4 platinum, and 1 a platinum plus. The bottom line is he was very successful. You know, he was a successful country music entertainer. In fact, I remember his television show, you know, that was on for a while. Now, in 2011, he and his wife decided they wanted to do one last concert tour. And at the age of 75, they decided that they were going to go across America and do this tour. But before that happened, a few weeks before it was supposed to start, he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. Now, you have to understand, Alzheimer's is a devastating illness that attacks your mind first before it takes hold of your body. And the doctors recommended that he not go, that he just hang it up. But he said, no, I'm going to do it. So what was supposed to be a 5-week tour of just 151 concerts, well, it was supposed to be a 5-week tour, but it turned out to be a tour of 151 concerts ending in Napa Valley in California in 2013. When he did this tour, they made a documentary about it, and it's called I Will Be Me. Now, this documentary is special in that it wasn't chronicling Glenn's tour, musical tour, but it was focusing on Alzheimer's. And in that documentary, the last song he recorded was I Am Not Going to Miss You. Now, it's a strange title for a song, but actually it had to do with Alzheimer's. Because if you've known anyone with this disease, you know that these individuals begin to forget things. And gradually, that person kind of just goes away. And in Glenn's family's case, their father, you know, their husband, their friend just went away. Although they missed him, he had gotten to the point where he couldn't miss them at all. You know, think about it. The sad irony of Alzheimer's is that you can only miss what you remember. When you can't remember somebody, you don't miss them. As the disease took hold of Glenn, he could no longer speak for himself. His family had to speak for him. So as we begin to explore today's passage in Ecclesiastes, though it doesn't specifically address Alzheimer's, at the end it does speak about the effects of aging on our body itself. Now, Solomon himself was probably old when he wrote Ecclesiastes. You know, we've mentioned that earlier on. Therefore, he had a lot of wisdom that comes with age, including a lot of experience. Now, based on our understanding of Solomon, we know that he had a bit of a melancholy and Eeyore-type personality. This is why that in today's passage, he's directing his wisdom towards the youth and the importance of remembering their Creator while they're still young. Ecclesiastes 11, 7 to 8 reads, "Light is sweet, and it pleases the eyes to see the sun. However many years anyone may live, let them enjoy them all. But let them remember the days of darkness, for there will be many. Everything to come is meaningless." This passage is basically saying, regardless if life is meaningless, we should at least enjoy it. Not just a part of life, we should enjoy all of life, the good and the bad, because, as he said, the bad days are going to come. In fact, for some of us, the sun may never go away. Now, he's directing this primarily toward the youth. And we know that because he says this in the first part of verse 8. And continuing down into 9, it says, "You who are young, be happy while you are young, and let your heart give you joy in the days of your youth. Follow the ways of your heart and whatever your eyes see." Now, this probably isn't a verse that parents of teens really want to share with them, you know, while they're in that time frame. It's like telling them, whatever you want to do, just go do it. Follow your desires. And in fact, if you're not careful, you know, your teen could use this passage against you. Because if you're getting a little too restrictive on their comings and goings, they could say, "Listen, you know, Brother Oscar preached on this in church, so I'm just doing what he said." Now, we know Solomon wouldn't get any best parenting awards because it seems like he's encouraging a life without boundaries, especially if you read this as an isolated text. And some people often do. They'll pull it out and just say, "Read this." But you have to notice here in verse 9, that there's a comma after this sentence. And what follows the comma is a qualifier. It says, "But know that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment." You know, Solomon's saying, yes, enjoy life. Dig yourself into life because it's going to get harder as you get older. Enjoy life, but do it responsibly. You know, where do we hear that commercial? You know, drink responsibly. He's saying live your life responsibly. Think before you act. Even though you may be, you know, the youth may be going away from home and your parents are not around to judge you, there's a Creator out there that's very capable of judging you. And when he does, he's going to take action. Solomon's encouraging us to enjoy the gifts that have been given, the wonderful gift of life, but to do it with moderation. Know when to say yes and know when to say no. Now, if you grew up as a Christian in a Christian home, you have a built-in, what we would say, lie detector. Our culture calls it a conscience, but here in the church, we call it the Holy Spirit. If we're willing to consult the Holy Spirit to determine when to say yes or when to say no, it will allow us to make good decisions. But unfortunately, a lot of young people make decisions based on how they feel. You know, what is that? If it feels good, do it. You know, how do I feel about this? What is it going to do for me? How is it going to affect my feelings and my desires and my passions? What happens is children follow their passions, and if they continue to make decisions based on those passions, they're going to hit a wall. It's just a matter of time. A passage in the Bible that I believe every student should take with them and remember, you know, when they go off to college, is Proverbs 16:25. There is a way that appears to be right, but in the end, it leads to death. Have you ever been in a situation where it seemed just so right? How could it, you know, be wrong? It's because the devil is basically telling you that it's okay. He wants you to screw up. He wants you to make decisions based on your feelings rather than the Word of God. Solomon speaking of the idea of enjoying life, but he also cautions us to enjoy it with a sense of responsibility. And then Solomon shifts his focus and moves from the enjoyment of life to remembering our Creator. Ecclesiastes 12:1. Remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the days of trouble come and the years approach when you will say, I find no pleasure in them. Now, this passage isn't saying to just enjoy our Creator in our youth and forget about Him when we get old. We're to constantly remember our Creator. But you know what the bottom line is? We have short memories. That's the sad thing. You know, we have the Lord's Supper. We celebrate the Lord's Supper here, not because it's an ordinance of our church, but because we need to remember the most central event in all history, the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So what Solomon's suggesting is that there's something about being young that if you remember your Creator or learn about the Creator when you are young, it'll carry over into adulthood. There's a statistic, and I don't know from where it came, but apparently 80% of people come to Christ before they're 18. Now, I don't know about you, but when you start hitting your 30s and 40s and 50s, you're pretty much set in your ways. Older people, I don't know why, just don't like change. Now, how many of you senior citizens here get up in the morning and say, oh, I want some change this week. I really do want to do something crazy. Let me tell you, no, you don't. As you get older in life, it becomes difficult to accept change or accept anything new, including a new faith. Remember in the Gospels when the people were bringing their little children to Jesus and the disciples started shooing them away, saying, "Don't bother him." What was Jesus' response? Luke 18:16. "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Now, what did Jesus mean by that? He meant that children are naturally receptive to God, where adults aren't. Adults have so much junk in their brains that they can't think about God things. This is why Vacation Bible School is so important. We know we can, you know, in Vacation Bible School, we know if we can get the children to hear the basic stories and capitalize on that receptivity to God before the world gets a hold of them, then when they grow up, when they get older, they're going to stay with God. They're going to have Jesus as a lifelong companion. Proverbs 22:6 tells us, "Start children off on the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it." Now, remember, that's not a guarantee. This is a wisdom proverb. You know, it's generally true, yes. And it's generally true that if parents raise a child in the way he should go, he won't depart from it. But if he does depart, there's a good chance he's going to come back. That's what's being talked about here. When Solomon says to remember your Creator while you're young, he's not just referring to remember your Creator while you're a little child. He's referring to that strange, weird generation or demographic known as the 20-somethings. Now, you think the 20-somethings, oh, that's 21, 22. No, the 20-somethings is between 18 and 32. And it's a hard generation to figure out. These 20-somethings are still in the developmental period of their life. Their spirit is being formed and shaped either by the church or by the world. And when our children get out of high school and they're released into the world, they're still developing. Then all of a sudden, they're off to college. You know, regardless that they grew up in the church their whole life, they say, you know, when you ask them, "Did you ever find a good church home yet?" You know, they're going to say, "No, I'm just not interested in it anymore. Church isn't for me." What do? You panic. What's going on here? But you don't have to panic. If you've allowed those seeds sown in your child when they were young and in their teens through youth group and everything else, you can be pretty sure that those seeds will someday sprout. But they're going to sprout on their own terms. I don't know of a 20-something that would sit and listen to a felt board presentation about Jesus and take it in like a sponge. They're not going to do that. You know, you have to change your methods. The 20-somethings are basically taught to question everything, including God. But if we create a safe place where the kids that are interested in coming back to God are free to ask all the questions they want, knowing they're not going to get slammed if there's a hint of disbelief, you know, they may come back to the faith. Then, when they come back to the faith, whether it's at 20 or 30, 40 or 50, their faith is going to be stronger because it's going to be their faith, not their parents' faith, not their family's faith, not their church's faith, but their faith. They had those seeds sown in them. Even though they've rejected traditional church, for the most part, they haven't rejected God. So when they're out there expanding their wings and trying to experience life, and suddenly they start hitting head on the realities of life, there's a good chance they're going to seek out a church. They want some kind of stability, like the stability that comes from a solid church family. That's what they really want. And then Solomon shifts from remembering the Creator before trouble sets in to speak about the trouble that's often associated with the aging process. Isn't that right, Bill? You know. Ecclesiastes 12:2. Remember your Creator before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars grow dark and the clouds return after the rain. When you get older, you have a storm cloud that comes into your life. But let me tell you, it isn't always followed by a sunny day. Another cloud could come in behind it, then another period of rain over and over again. And he goes on and does some very creative imagery here in this chapter. He uses about 10 or 11 images comparing the aging process to a decaying house. He says, remember your Creator before the days of trouble come, when the keepers of the house tremble. Well, what part of your body is the keeper of the house? What part of your body maintains your house? What part of your body builds the house? Well, it's your hands. Yeah. Anybody try to maintain a house when your hands start shaking, you know, trembling? Has anybody's hands gotten shaky as they've gotten older? And he says, and the strong men stoop. Well, what's this? Well, that's your back. Your body and legs not being able to bear the weight of your body anymore. When the grinders cease because they're few, well, that's your teeth. Anybody missing a few teeth out there? Not going to mention any names this time. If anything, there is a very good case for flossing while you're young, you know. And those looking through the windows that grow dim, you know, we're talking about eyes. Instead of being able to use those glasses off the shelf at Walmart, you have to pay $700 or more for a pair of bifocals or progressive lenses. Then he goes on to say, when the doors to the street are closed. Well, think about that one. What are the doors to the street? It's your ears. You hear noise from the outside, you know, outside your door. Pretty soon, you can't hear that noise. And then you have to end up buying hearing aids. Yeah. Or he says, when men rise up at the sound of birds, you know, he's talking about light sleepers. You may not hear all the noise outside, but if a bird ends up on your windowsill and starts chirping, you're wide awake. And then, but all their songs grow faint. You know, and that suggests what happens as you age. Your vocal cords tend to stretch out. You can't hit the high notes anymore. It accounts for the raspy voice some people get. And then he goes on, when men are afraid of heights and of dangers in the streets. Now, Is there anyone out here afraid to climb a ladder besides Cora? You know, because you might fall, you know. Yeah. Did you fall, Cora? Yes. So, you know, we have to think about that. Dangers in the street isn't referring just to bandits, but just walking down streets that weren't paved, where you might trip over something and not be able to get up. When the almond trees blossom, well, that's in reference to gray hair. From a distance, the almond tree looks like a man with a white head of hair. And the grasshopper drags himself along. Energy level, you know. You just don't have that excitement and the vitality of life anymore. And he closes by saying, then man goes to their eternal home and mourners go about the streets. You know, that's obviously a reference to dying. Now, in biblical times, they would pay people to go out in the streets and wail, especially if they didn't have enough friends or relatives to do that sort of thing. But he wraps this whole idea of remembering up by saying, remember him before the silver cord is severed and the golden bowl is broken, before the pitcher is shattered at the spring and the wheel broken at the well, and the dust returns to the ground it came from, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. Solomon has packed a lot of imagery in those verses. And what he's doing is he's equating life to a lamp. And remember, in biblical times, these lamps hung from the ceiling in a bowl. And he's saying, you know, he's showing an expensive gold bowl filled with oil hung from the ceiling by a silver cord. If that cord broke, the bowl would fall to the ground, breaking, spilling the oil, which is essentially the source of light. He's equating that to death. The other imagery was a pitcher used to fetch water. You know, like you're going to get water from the well, you fill the pitcher, and when you are bringing it back home, you stumble and drop it and it breaks. Well, another source of life. When you go to the well and you're using a wheel to pull the bucket up and that wheel's broken, you can't draw up the living water anymore. And what's interesting is this little bit of about dust in verse 7. It says, and the dust returns to the ground it came from, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. He's basically suggesting that death reverses creation. In Genesis, remember, man was formed out of dust. The Spirit of God was breathed into the person. At death, the man returns to death and the Spirit goes back to God. It's a picture of the sadness of death. It demonstrates a reversal of the created order. Now, Solomon's idea in these passages wasn't to depress us, but to motivate and encourage us to remember our Creator. And he ends this passage the same way he began it in chapter 1, by saying, meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, everything is meaningless. Now, at this stage in his life, Solomon, you know, like I mentioned, had a very melancholy view of life. But, you know, of life and death. But as bad as death was, he still thought life was better. And he still wanted to hang on to it, if he could, to this particular life. Now, today we can ask why. You know, why would he want to hang on to life if it's so bad? Well, our view of death is different than Solomon's, since we have eternal life. Solomon didn't understand God the way that we understand him today. Solomon saw the afterlife as a shadowy, no man's type land of existence where you just kind of sort of hung around. He didn't see it as a paradise. He didn't have the advantage and the view we have when we talk about aging and dying. He didn't have the benefit of the cross. Everyone here is aging and experiencing all sorts of things. You know, yes, there are a lot of painful things to go through. But you know what? We know what's on the other side. We know to what it's leading. That's why strong Christians just don't sit around and bemoan the aging process. They become like Paul, that, you know, we read this verse earlier, Philippians 1:21, "For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain." Now those words are hard words to say when you're aging. But if I think about it, I suspect if Paul were here today and we were able to ask him, "You've lived under the sun and over the sun, which do you prefer?" You know, he would definitely say life over the sun with Christ. And you know what? I don't remember much of that old life. And I think, like Paul, what's going to happen is when we get to the other side, we're going to have a very limited memory of this time of life, if at all. And if Solomon were alive today and had the advantage of seeing things from the perspective of the cross, I suspect he might have ended his book a little bit differently. I suspect he might have added a postscript to it. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, everything is meaningless. P.S. I'm not going to miss you. You know, what's there to miss from this life? We get to the other side, and there will be nothing to miss because we're going to be in the presence of God. Now, this is pure speculation on my part, but I actually think it's part of the reason that as we age in life, we forget things and our memory fades. I believe this is intentional because the only memory we need to carry into eternity is the memory of God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning recognizing that everyone ages. We go through different stages in life, some good, some bad, but yet in the end, it boils down to one thing. Everyone passes, but where we go after that is the important part. We all want to live with Christ. We all want to go to heaven. But yet, not everyone will. Not everyone has heard the news of Jesus and his saving grace of dying on the cross. And we have to think about that as we go out in the world, that some of these people are going to die and they're not going to enjoy an afterlife with God. And so, Lord, just help keep in our minds this thought of knowing that we can share with others a saving grace, that they too can enjoy Jesus as much as we do. And we just ask that you continue to watch over us and to guide us, to help us understand this, to be faithful. And we ask this in your holy name. Amen.